I never thought 20 years from the time we started this design that the car would still exist and be so beautiful. So you should really give a plus to yourself. It's wonderful. It's unbelievable. Over the last few years, most of you probably heard from me. So today I'm going to introduce you to Parkinson with you, to you, and he's really known as Parki. Before doing that, let me explain you something that probably many of you are not quite familiar with. The question is how a car comes alive, how it's designed. And there's a lot of mystery to it. Many people stop me on the street or neighbors. Why don't you have V8 in it, and why do you have this tire, that transmission in it? But let me tell you why not. There are six really major phases to a problem. Somebody, somewhere, comes with an idea that there must be a new car. And the program planners, which party belongs to, they are the guys that really put together data from the marketplace and try to make sense out of the product and prepare a material that they can sell to the corporation, saying that this product is really good for the company, is good for the division, and we must really design and release this car. If they can convince the executives who don't know how to design a car, that is really tricky. And then once they do that, then they come, they say, now we sold something, can you design this? He said, what the hell did you sell? And after a lot of closed door discussions, you find out what the hell they sold. And then you design the car. The first thing you do really, that's phase one, is marketing asset. The phase two, you have to, because they come back with a budget. You see, people don't realize that we design a car to a budget and to a facility that exists, and not like entrepreneurs do. They sit down and dream something and they think there is no limit to money. There's no such thing. There's a very limited money and there's a very limited facility that you have to design the vehicle to. So the second phase is to take their input, saying, okay, you have got $1, $10, $100 million, whatever it is. Say, here's the money we have got for this program. Here's the volume. Go design a car for us. So the first thing you have to do is package this car with the components and the facilities and the production capability, et cetera, put together. You make a master drawing layout. Then, of course, at this time, the marketing people are bugging you every day. They come, what did you do? Why did you do it? And et cetera. So we try to entertain them and babysit them. And send them home. then you make a package and you make a seating box. Now that's a very static vehicle. What it is really is demonstrates how the people will sit, where the steering is, where the pedals are. We call it ergonomics. And the ergonomics, you see, he and I are not the tall of the population. Our chief was 6'4". And stuffing a 6'4 into Fiero is not an easy job. So we have to get his dimensions and make a so-called, we used to call him Oscar, but we call that Bobby because his name was Robert. So we made a model of him and tried to put it in the design so it would fit, because if he doesn't like it, we won't pass the damn car, you see? So we made it fit. Then, this is the page, it's a very static car. Then it goes to styling, and styling is another problem too, because the styling people are very emotional, as you may know. They go all the way from arguing with you to crying. And they start designing, and you argue about you can't do this, you can't do that, and they'll say, but how come Mercedes is doing it? We say, our car is $8,000, Mercedes is $80,000. That's the difference, that's why we can't make it. They don't understand that kind of language. Anyway, so you end up with a clay model, that's again a static car. In the third phase, we go and build a prototype. The first time you build it, you don't know whether it will work or not. Usually it doesn't. They bring it down the hoist, they crank it, it doesn't start. So you have to find the guy that knows about the engine, not the engineers, the mechanics. engineers don't know how to start the engine. So the mechanics come in and then they fix it. You drive it and you're surprised. These are what we designed, you know. Then comes really, that's the first time it comes live. Then you give it to the development engineers. Those guys are magic. They have got sandpaper fingers and sandpaper butts. They drive the car and they start measuring the cars and then they figure out the characteristics of the vehicle. Then it gets real sophisticated, but anyway, they start developing the vehicle. That's they do that generates a lot of changes in the mechanical devices, and we do those incorporated, and the car comes alive. That's what the car is. The spirit of the car comes with the development, not with the static car. Okay? And then we release the car, obviously, and it takes a lot of effort and pain to get a plan started. Once you start, there are other problems which I will not get into. In any event, but as I said, the start of it is really the marketing. Without that start, nothing happens. So with that, I'll turn over to Parki. He can explain some of the backroom stories probably about the vehicle.
So all those years you were babysitting me, Hulki. First of all, let me thank you for the invitation. Claire and I have enjoyed Fieros. Had one of the very first Fieros in 1984, and we enjoyed an 88 GT until just recently. We gave it to our grandson, who will be driving next year, and he owes me all A's and B's, and then he can drive it. So he's here tonight. So. The cars out there, you know, when I was a young man, when Hulki and I were younger men, we never dreamed that we would see the kind of devotion, the kind of energy, and the kind of love that we saw today that you have for our vehicle. It's unbelievable. Hulki, I have a question. You know, when I defined the car, and I was literally telling him what to do, or trying to tell him what to do. I wanted a performance version right out of the chute, and I wanted a V6 or a V8. You told me, oh, I don't think we can do that. Arkie, you know, but these guys got a Cadillac V8 in it. How did they do that and you couldn't do that?
I'll tell you why not.
I hope it's the same answer as you told me 20 years ago.
What we have to do, we have to pick the rocks. We have to make a drawing first. And if we cannot make the drawing, we cannot turn it to the shop. These guys start with an engine and a car and with a bunch of saws and welders in their hand, and they fit it.
Yep. Okay, send it someone right now.
Yeah, basically, we don't have the courage that these guys have.
Well, let me give you a little background as to my involvement in the Fiero program. I was there at ground zero. It was kind of my idea to do a two-place vehicle. It was certainly not called Fiero then. It didn't have a mid-engine configuration. It didn't have X-car rear suspensions or T-car front suspensions or any of that marvelous ingenuity and genius that Hulki drove into the vehicle. But what it was a kernel of an idea that was really driven from a number of variables that Pontiac Motor Division was facing back in the fall of 1978. At that period of time, Pontiac sales were going in the dumpers. The image of the division was not very strong. It had gone from a performance-oriented division to a, I don't want to say old man's car division, but older man's car division. And so as the head of strategic planning for Pontiac, I was challenged by Bob Stemple, who was our boss, to continuously look for opportunities that might help the division turn around. And we thought that sporty two-place or sporty small vehicles was one way that that might be accomplished, driven by a number of not only internal needs, but also marketing needs. We saw a lot of our competitors, Ford, Fiat, and some of the other imports coming in. There was Honda looming on the horizon with passenger vehicles or small sporty vehicles. The other half of the equation was being driven by fuel economy. At that time, as you all may recall, or some of you may recall, the country was in the midst of a kind of an energy situation. General Motors was forced, really, because of that, to redesign its entire product lineup. Hulki had a lot to do with some other vehicles that helped General Motors achieve the fuel economy as well as the Fiero. But we thought in the strategic planning group then that in the back room of a of our planning conference room in October, or actually late September, that if we had the opportunity to ever put in front of the corporation an idea for a small, sporty car, that it would appeal to what we call the new values group that was emerging in the country, that it would be a winner for not only the corporation, but for Pontiac as well. So lo and behold, the Future Product Conference pops its head up, and what that was a symposium of the top 200 executives with a room about this size, with every executive that meant anything and had any decision power in the company sitting in. And there was a little table right here that had the top 10 or 12 guys, and each division was asked to come in and present their ideas for new products that would help CAFE. So quickly, my staff and I, we met and we figured that this was our opportunity. Let's put on the table and this two-place vehicle. Now, it didn't come easy because we argued about F-specials and J-specials and F-car derivatives and lots of other things, but it was, we eventually settled on proposing a two-place vehicle. And the way we did that, and how it hooked to fuel economy, is we kind of wrote down on a piece of paper that if we could get 50 miles per gallon, out of this vehicle, and we could sell about 75,000 of those, that would be equal to the kind of investment it would take for an all-new transmission module that would gain the same kind of CAFE improvement. So I don't want to bore you with all that, but essentially that was why we decided to put this on the table. So we did. Now, you all know this car died 100 times, maybe 1,000 times, and I had to revive it through presentations for a number of years, it seemed, right?
No idea.
But this concept, okay, it's Halloween day, by the way. October 31st or whatever, and it's 1978, and there's all the top guys. And my boss, Courtney Jones at the time, didn't know anything about product. Hulki doesn't think I know too much about product, but this guy even knew less than I did. He was my boss. So he's given the pitch, and before we can get to defining what we really want to put on the table here and get their approval, the slide projector starts on fire. In front of thousands of executives, our slideshow melts down. But you know, it was really, in the end, it was an appropriate thing to have happen because we stopped right there, obviously, and Pete Estes and Jim McDonald and all the big guys back then told us to go back, research your slides, and come back at the end of the day, and we'll hear what you had to say. As it turns out, that was the best thing that ever happened because at the end of the day, we had the floor to ourselves, we had 100% of their attention. We laid out the idea of a two-place vehicle, and Pete Estes and Jim McDonald bought it. And they said, go do the car. So my staff and I were driving back from Lansing, because that's where the meeting was, to Pontiac. And I'm like the marketing guy or the planning guy that was chasing the bus. and I caught it. Now I didn't know what the hell I was going to do with it. They wanted me to do a two-place vehicle. I didn't know how the hell to do a two-place vehicle that was supposed to do all these things that we put up there on the slide. 50 miles per gallon, going to get 100,000 units a year. So we got back to the division, and lo and behold, out of the heavens fell this guy here. And worked with Hulki to hold his hand and kind of define for him what the market wanted. But it was this guy, the genius of this guy, who, given the kind of parameters that I laid out, the kind of pricing targets, the kind of investment targets, the kind of fuel efficiency targets, and kind of the timing targets that put this whole thing together. So that's just one story. Hulki, do you want to give a story, or are you? We have nothing really planned. We're just kind of bouncing back and forth, but that's kind of where I fit in this whole thing. I kind of came up with the concept. It sure as hell wasn't called Fiero back then, but it was soon to become the P car.
Yeah, one comment. He never was so kind to me like he said.
So, hey, another story I got to tell you is a P car. Parki, you hear? That's what they used to call me, P-car. You get the connection? As the head of strategic planning for Pontiac, I got a call one day to go over to Fisher Body, because nothing moved in the company if you didn't have a letter designation behind it or ahead of it. And so I traipsed over to Fisher Body, and they said, hey, you got to choose a letter for this. If you're going to go forward to PPG and get concept approval and do all of that stuff, and have a real car program, we gotta put a letter on this thing. So I said, okay, what are the letters? Well, they had a few letters, but they had P available. So I said, hey, P, sounds good to me. But I told Hulki when I came back, it was really P for Pontiac, but it really was P for Parki.
One quick sort of a short story about the car. This PPG he referred to is product planning group that really of the, top dogs of the corporation.
Yeah, they had about 20 guys, and there were 10 guys voted, and those are the guys you had to grease.
But you understand, many of them cannot even drive the car. They have chauffeurs. So we built the first prototype at Milford Fab. That was, I don't know, Thursday, I think, was a PPG day.
PPG Thursday.
Yeah, Thursday. So Wednesday night at 12 o'clock, we almost finished painting the car. We're trying hot air on it to dry it. And at 8 o'clock, we pulled it to the tech center. No sign of the tech center right at, Troy. There's a little ride area for the executives. So we put the car over there, and then they are driving. And we are sort of standing on the side, see what happens. Out of those six guys, four guys came and said, this looks like an Italian car you got in export. Says, where is your program? We said, this is the car, guys. And then I realized that many of them, that was a stick shift, incidentally. I found out why they couldn't drive, because they start their car in gear with a starter and never use clutch. And you should see the car jerk around. Then you realize these guys don't drive, and they have drivers. So that was an interesting story at the time. We laughed at it, of course. You can't laugh to their face, but when you go to the office, you laugh your butt off.
So after the Future Product Conference, we come back, Hulki gets on board, and soon, right next to my office, he's erected this place where he's building out of sticks and all kinds of weird materials, this thing that none of us guys in planning really knew what it was, but turned out it was the first seating buck that Hulki talked about, and he did that in record-breaking time. At the same time, we were preparing to go forward to our concept approval, which would really give us the, with, again, this product policy group, set of gentlemen, that would really give us the opportunity to spend some money, we thought. And I wrote that pitch, and we went, and it was Bob Stemple who actually gave that presentation that day. It was the most eloquent dissertation on
the need for this vehicle, the need for a Fiero P car at that time. And we thought we would be given money, but they said, go ahead and do the car, go ahead and build one. But we didn't get any money. So how did you do this, Hulki? We didn't get any money that day.
Let me tell you, it's interesting in the corporation. It's a big corporation, and obviously there's a lot of money not to spend. It's just in the bank or somewhere. But it turns out to be certain individuals in the corporation have got credibility in the shops outside of General Motors. You can go ask them to do a job, they'll do it because they know they'll get their money. Except the bookkeepers in General Motors, they don't quite understand the concept. How can you get anything done without a work order? Well, it turns out to be outside shops trust individuals, but not the corporation. So they do the job, and then you have to make the bookkeeper to go and pay. One guy, once I owed about over $3 million. So, I said,
Hulki Jim, had a lot of credibility.
I said, Jim, we have to, this is a financial guru. I said, we have to get to pay these guys. He says, you know, there is no way we can do that. So he goes downtown, and after about 2 weeks, he came back. He says, Hulki, he says, I got it done. But I'll tell you something. He says, you do it once more. He says, I'm going to kill you because there's no solution for this kind of behavior. So since then, I have to find other ways to get the job done.
So on we went, and Hulki built a fabulous seating model. And it came time to really, as Hulki says, to get some bucks to start paying some people to get this program really rolling. So we decided to have a fairly substantial meeting where Hulki was going to show the seating model to the top boys, Pete Estes and all the guys at the corporation. And we decided to do it at design staff, and then we put the seating model there, and we had the clay, which Hulki had been working with John Chanel on and Ron Hill. And you know, we're looking at this thing about 10 minutes before the big guys were supposed to show up, and all of a sudden we start realizing, I don't know anything about product now, but there's a part missing. And I'm going, oh my God, you know, I think Hulki's forgotten something here. You know, I talked to one of the guys that worked for him. I said, hey, Denny, there's no parking brake in this car. Where's the parking brake? So Hulki, will you want to explain how we forgot the parking brake? At least one time? You had it all worked out though, right? He even thought about the parking brake.
We did. We just guest thing being in the center, there was no way we could make it work. Actually, that was a getting on the side was quite a development program. We didn't have a hand, you know, brake for a while, but you have to let go and have faith.
But as it turns out, the big guys came in, reviewed the car, loved it, and didn't notice that there wasn't a parking brake in the car. And we were off to the races. A lot of very difficult work then really started. Hulki's team started to put the vehicle together, and of course the first red car, I don't know where that car is today, I'd love to know where it is, was built and finished. And we started to show it for real around the corporation, and that's where my work really started. Because once we got approval, the car began to become very controversial in the company, and just about everybody and their uncle was out to kill it, or did kill it at one time. And I had so many different presentations or renditions of presentations. I had one that I could take to the manufacturing guys. I had one that was financially derived. I had one that was styling aimed at how the design was going to be. I had one that was from a manufacturing standpoint. So anybody who raised a question, I had the answer. But I always had to go to Hulki. Now Hulki, I know, was holding my hand and trying to, you know, send me home and go away, Parki. But as a team, we did one heck of a job in terms of pushing that through the corporation. Unfortunately, I didn't stay until the end of the program, until I didn't see the introduction of the car. The company saw fit to send me off to do other things. I went to Korea, of all places, and I did a joint venture over there. And so I missed the launch, the very important marketing launch, although I was invited back for that. That was one big blast. The last thing, though, I did for the car was during its very, very early launch phase, we got all the press people on board. And it was my job to go to Washington, D.C. and to New York City and get all the opinion leaders on board. And the way we did this was incredible. We went in a restaurant, hung a sheet, literally, up on the wall, and I stood like I'm standing tonight and talked to slides with some of the biggest press and some of the biggest politicians in the country, talking about what this car could do for not only Pontiac, but the industry, and how the fuel efficiency could benefit the country in its entirety. So that's kind of where I bowed out, and I went on to Korea and did Le Mans. Don't hold that against me. That was a bigger program than the car. There was a lot of strategic stuff that went on behind the scenes that program was all about. But do you have anything else, Hulki, that you want to talk about? Maybe you can jog my memory and maybe we take some questions or something?
No, the most important thing I think you have to understand, in a corporation like General Motors, Ford, Chrysler, all those, without product planners, you can't get a program started. So it's a very important component of the system. So for that, thanks, Parki.
Thank you, Hulki. But our paths crossed again later in life after my Korean escapades. I worked at Saturn, did the Saturn program, and we brought Hulki in to actually get that car off the ground. So again, another space frame, another plastic skin car, right? So thank you very much. If you want to ask us some questions, we're more than open to that, right, Hulki? I think you'll answer anything that's reasonable. So raise your hand.
I got one. Parki, tell me about whatever you know. Where did the Fiero name come from?
Fiero name came, well, there was a number of names in contention. The sales guys wanted Sunfire. Fiema or something like that was in contention. Fiero came from John Chinella, and actually I believe it was either John Chinella or his wife who found the car name at the very 11th and a half hour. It was going to be a big meeting. Bill Hoagland had told everybody, said, we're going to name the car today. Nobody's coming out of this room to this car's name. And I want all you guys to come in here and give us ideas. Well, everybody came and gave it ideas, and John piped up over in the corner and says, well, I think Fiero might be pretty good. Well, whoa. And it was.
Right? Is that
kind of how it happened?
You know, this ticket has a emblem on it, too. It is a flying horse. The name of the car was Pegasus. We released a steering wheel with that emblem on. And this corporate politics brought the name Fiero. So the only thing we could do with it is really print it on the car. And the car came out with a steering wheel that has a Pegasus on it. And this is part of the big corporate politics.
Yeah, Pegasus we took to market. And while a lot of the corporate executives didn't like that name, we actually went out and did a lot of customer research, which I probably should talk about. But in the development of this car, to give Hulki some feedback on his mid-engine ride, his four-wheel disc brakes ride, his plastic skins ride, and all that kind of stuff. Hulki went and did it anyways. He didn't care what I was saying, but as it turns out, he did exactly what the market was wanting. But customers struggled with Pegasus. They didn't know how to pronounce it. Couldn't spell it, couldn't pronounce it. So once that kind of data got into Bill Hoagland's hands, it was like, we're not going to do that. So that's kind of the background there.
You understand something else about the corporation. Corporation is like a family too. You know, when a grandchild is born, everybody wants to name the kid. And when the program was really teetering over whether it'll start or not, everybody hides. Once they found out that the program is real, now everybody wants to name the damn thing. That's what happens.
You know, you guys have a lot go ahead. Way over here.
Now that they killed the poor kid, do you think there's anybody looking back in retrospect saying, gee, we should have followed through with this? You've got a lot of support here, obviously, but it's not that much. But, you know, you don't have that type of war. What went wrong, really, here? Just the initial problem.
I'm going to let you take that one, Hulki. There's a number of reasons why. I'm sure that I don't know the exact reasons why the company did away with the vehicle. Believe me, there's a lot of business reasons, but I'm sure there was a lot of political reasons as well. But Hulki may be closer to that.
I answered that question many times, and depending on the audience, you can change the answer. But yeah, there are a couple of things that are undoubtedly the right reasons. One of them is GM never learned to design and build cars at low volume. GM either builds 250,000 cars a year or nothing. And Fiero plant was really efficient. It was set at 30,000 really, and overtime 35,000 per shift. And that's really one tool set of production line. And the budget was right to it, so it worked all right. The plant had 800 people in it, and it was very profitable the first 2 years. Then comes corporate reliability and manufacturing and so on. They found out this plant was not in line with the rest of the plants in terms of departments and manpower and controls. So they put controls and it became 1,200 people suddenly. And if you take a 30,000 volume car and put 1,200 people, which 200,000 car plant can stand, you suddenly your overhead goes to hell. And that's what happened. That's one reason. So the profitability of the plant started going down. Then internally, there was a lot of opinions, including the chairman, you know, at that time. So they didn't like the idea that we are, you see, Pontiac had a little character of being independent. They were mavericks. Everybody in it was a little bit not quite GM type people, including Parki. So they didn't like that attitude. You know, it's a big bureaucracy, it doesn't like that kind of attitude. So we were not the favorite sons over there. So there are a lot of other political reasons too that we weren't really privileged to, but somehow at the end, chairman killed it. So we have to find the right guy that really signed the papers to kill it at the end, but we can't find him. He's hiding or something.
He's long gone. No, but the corporation did recognize the, I'd say the spirit that drove the vehicle, and for whatever reasons, most of the people that worked on Fiero ended up in very high positions in the company, ended up doing a lot of very, I would say, significant jobs for the company, as well as developing very, very good cars that went forward. You just look at the executives that were at Pontiac, most of them ended up either almost running the company or practically running the company for years. So it was recognized that it was a highly talented, integrated, well-oiled team that had a lot of esprit de corps. So it was a hell of a thing to work, be a part of, and work on. You know, it reminds me your passion for the vehicle and your love for tinkering with your cars reminds me of some of the same passion that I saw in the market research that we did very early on in the program. We knew that this car was going to be a hit. Hulki built a little fiberglass replica for me to go out and go around the country. I went to 7 or 8 cities and showed the vehicle along with the seating buck. And the feedback was phenomenal. This car was an instant hit. People loved it, especially ladies. They loved the car. So we knew it was going to be a hit right out of the chute. Yes, we're here. It means proud, I believe, Hulki. I think it means proud one or something like that.
Right, it's
I'd have to go back in the archives, but I think that's what it means. I
If I understand it, it's Italian, all right, but it's one of the romantic side of the language. It is a poetic language rather than the street language. So Fiero comes from there, I understand.
1970s energy market conditions seem to be returning. I mean, is GM even re-looking at this decision that they made some time ago to kill the Fiero?
Well, right now, probably, of course, you hear a lot about the hydrogen engines and so on. Probably the next wave of fuel economy will come from more efficient engines rather than the product line. Product line is going to show up, especially in the market that we have. When people want something, they'll get it. Because if you don't, people are over in this country, they don't buy the product. It is not enough that you think the product is good. If the people don't think it's good, they don't buy it, regardless whether it's fuel efficient or not. But the fuel economy that the government is pushing, and all of us are of course pushing, has to come from efficiencies. And hydrogen engine, compound engines, etc., probably are the right thing to do. Right now the Toyota and Hyundai vehicles with the compound engines are really outstanding. And I retired about 5 years now. A couple years before I retired, I worked on some of those programs. I don't know what the status is right now. I'm sure they're much more advanced at this point in time. But we'll have that kind of engines.
Yeah, I retired about a year ago, and the corporation is very, very cognizant of the energy situation and very astute politically in terms of how they're gonna do that and how they're gonna meet the objectives. Yes, sir, way in the back. Variant that got dropped out of the program because we were sold this thing as a sports commuter, but we always wanted to do a performance variant, and I was pushing for that. Now, Hulki may have gone a little overboard, and he might want to speak to that. On a couple of little prototypes he had running around.
Yeah, the original car was V8. We had a corporation had an aluminum V8, and we almost tooled that. And that was a real outstanding engine, and with a turbo, water-cooled turbo in it, it was very fast. It is true, we had insulation, and we blew the doors out of Corvette. The only problem is we got caught doing that. So at the proving ground, there's an east thing. Straight away, and we were racing with it, and somebody took pictures and sent it downtown, so we got a little reprimand on that. Yes, that you know, there's no question marketing came very strong recommendations, get this engine faster and so on. They told us not only fuel economy, but also there was an engine capacity issue. They said, look, here's an engine plant that has got excess capacity that'll cost you nothing. If you want that V8 engine, then it's going to cost you money which you don't have the budget for. Which one do you want? We said, we want the car, so we took the four-cylinder. You know, these are the realities that are on big corporations.
Trade-offs.
Trade-offs.
First question is there any chance that
That's I appreciate your enthusiasm, and but I really doubt if you can we can bring that. All the tools are right now destroyed. I know they have been, you know, melted down to liquid iron probably. So it's not available, and I'm sure there will be other cars if the market demands the two-passenger or three-passenger, whatever it is. Corporations will react to it because they are looking for different products to sell. You cannot just build four doors forever and expect to stay in business. So.
Some of the new SSR that's coming out from Chevy this year is a, kind of a little two-passenger sport truck, sport performance truck. So companies always looking at niche vehicles and things that they can meet the individual little niche markets with. So, any other questions? Yeah. I don't know. Sorry. Yeah.
Was the Lotus involved at all in terms of the looks or either the four-wheel suspension?
Hulki, did you have Lotus on board? I didn't know about it.
No, I visited Lotus. I went to England, and for other reasons, I tell you why I went there. They said Lotus is a great paint job. You better go find out about it. So I went to London. They flew me into a Lotus. People that don't know where Lotus is, it's in the middle of farmland, and it's a Spitfire hangar that's a plant. There is no road to go there. You fly in. And they were welding the frame. I said, this is not fixtured. How do you keep this frame together? Oh, he says, over there, there's a farmer. He says, he's very good. He says, after he plows his fields, he'll come, and then you watch him. He says, well, he says, he won't distort anything. He says, wonderful guy. So I said, fine. I said, I really came here for the paint job. So we go, the paint job shop is smaller than this place. It's a little rail and a little booth. And there are a couple of guys out there with the sandpaper in their hand, wet sanders. And the car going in there and sanding and it's going and coming out again, they are sanding. I said, what's going on here? He says, we keep sanding this until the paint is good. So I came back and I said, how do they paint it? I said, they paint it until it's good. You know, we are trying to get the first time good. So Lotus is a very interesting car, but it's really a back alley shop. It is not a technology that you would go into building 200,000 cars. It's a single individual car that's great. But so are your cars over there too, with a Cadillac engine in it.
We have time maybe for a couple more. Yeah.
You developed this car based on the computer. What or how did it happen that you built a Super Duty that was on the track? It was a hell of an engine.
Okay, let me quickly answer that. Number one, we did not design a commuter car. We designed a sports car that's capable of handling unlimited amount of power, and the reason is very simple. See, there are three configurations on chassis. One is a front engine, rear drive, front engine, front drive, then rear engine, and rear engine comes into two flavors. One is like Porsche, which is rear engine, engine in the rear, and
behind
then
the axle.
Behind the axle, and then there is an engine in front, which is like Formula One cars. When you go there, that combination, which Fiero is, from there on, regardless the size of the vehicle, if you increase the power, all you have to do is put more tire to it. Bigger tire and bigger engine and bigger tire, so its speed is unlimited. Whereas if you have a front engine and rear drive, you spin out, you see? So the car was really designed to be a high performance, potentially high performance vehicle. That's why you can put a Cadillac V8 in it and drive. Or other, some hot rods stuff I've seen out there. You see, all you have to do is put a big tire in. And the way we got the 51 miles per gallon exactly, was a four-cylinder with a very wide ratio that was a real dog to drive, but you could get 51 miles per gallon, you see? So the car was a platform to make it hot, but we introduced it as a commuter.
Remember that the whole idea was to get the car sold. The only way to sell it was sporty commuter, cute little car. None of us ever believed we would not go forward without a performance variant. That was in our blood from day one. Yeah, go ahead.
Did the Fiat X19 have any kind of influence on the design?
What? The X19 have an influence on the design, Hulki? We had X19s all over the place, right?
Yeah.
We had in terms of size. That was a real difficult car to drive. As a matter of fact, we had one, and Stemple was the achieving general manager. I don't know if you ever met him, but he's a big guy. He's built like a farmer with big legs and butt. So, a real great guy, but that's the way he's built. So we got into it, and we are driving this at the proving ground. He couldn't get out of the car. He got locked between the steering wheel and the pedals. No, this is true. And it is that, and we call them this, it's designed for Italian gigolos.
Okay, one more, and then we'll get out of here. Way back here. Safety? I think so. Very good, right?
Yeah.
Actually, that's the only car at the time, it still is, on the corporation that passes all the barrier loads without airbag. Yeah. There's good data on it. You can check, you know, anywhere, but that's a fact.
Decided that since these two gentlemen spent a lot of time in putting up the Fiero Fanatics, that I'd make them a little something. So I made a little platform commemorating their speaking abilities and putting up with us. So, Hulki, here you go. Thank you. Except the wood and stainless steel. I also, these nice little keychains that everybody was buying this weekend, I want to present Hulki with number one, since he is. Don gets one too.
Thank you very much.
That were left over for some guest speakers that didn't come, so I have four left that are under number 10, so see me go off. Thank you.